For the past couple of years now, the name Dean Fuel is definitely among the most recognizable names in South Africa's electronic music scene. This is partly due to his compelling DJ sets, his lively and colorful production, and his extensive contribution to the culture, which includes Smark, his recently formed record label which aims to bring together like-minded artists and nurture new talent. In his youth, Dean Fuel started off playing in bands and was enamored with the world of rock and punk. But how did this angst-filled adolescence that was in love with punk music end up killing it in the dance and trance music space, to the point where he became one of the most booked DJs for the summer season? In this video, Dean Fuel walks us through some of the albums that had an immense impact on his life. If you'd like to find out more about the South African music scene, please do subscribe and hit the like button and follow us on our socials, as you'll find stuff that are not on our YouTube. You know what, guys? Let's get into it.
To pick a fifth album, Radiohead with Kid A came out in 2000. Specifically, the one track that just blew my mind was Idiotique on it. What I loved about that was also kind of a sense of something that had come full circle for me. Was as a kid that grew up on alternative and rock and that sort of music, getting exposed into electronic music, here was a band that I'd originally known as an alternative band that had shifted into electronic and did it insanely well. So yeah. The fourth album, kind of following this chronologically, would be Ronnie Size with New Forms. I think that was in 1998, if I'm not mistaken. What I loved about that album is that it helped me make sense of drum and bass.
It's the first music that was originated out of the UK, going back to the jungle days.
Drum and bass is that original rave energy, still moving, still traveling, still going forward, still developing.
At that point, it had kind of just been the sound called jungle, which was sort of often like a second dance floor at the raves, where it would be people going off to this completely different rhythm and beat structure to the more sort of 4-4 house, hard house, techno sort of sound that was being played on the main stage. And I loved it. It was like, yeah, also crazy energy. It had its own subculture, and so Ronnie Size came out, and that album, it was just a cool album, very musical, very well put together, very slick, and again, something that I could listen to happily today and just still get as much enjoyment from it. So the third album that I would have to mention, Daft Punk with Homework. You know, the tracks came out, a lot of them in 95, 96, but the album officially dropped in 97. And that, to this day, is still one of my all-time favorite albums. It is just pure vibe. It's fun, it's funky. They used a lot of sampling techniques. They sampled a lot of like disco records. And it was just these two young French guys that just came out of nowhere and basically changed the game. To this day, they probably will be cited as one of the biggest electronic acts of all time. And I got to say that as a teenager, like, I was there hearing it for the first time and having my mind properly blown by it. It wasn't necessarily the most complicated music. It wasn't the most out there. It was pure fun. It was pure dance floor. And to this day, you can drop a Daft Punk track, any track from that album, and the dance floor's gonna go after it anywhere in the world. One more time. I suppose as a producer, if I could make music that does that, I'd be very, very happy. So that's the third album. The second album would be Left Field Leftism, which came out in 1995. It really resonated with me because it was a great artist album, but where it wasn't really focused on a band or a brand around a band. It was just this creation. It was more like a piece of art. And you wouldn't know what was going to happen from one track to the next. You got a sense of a band or an artist making music that didn't really fit within any kind of walls of genre. And I just loved it. I absolutely loved it. I must have played that album over and over and over and over again, and to this day I still absolutely love it. Going back through my memories and looking back on crucial albums that meant a lot to me and obviously steered me in my journey to getting where I am today, probably the first one to really have a big impact on me would have been the Prodigy Music for a Jilted Generation. It was in 1994. Heard of the Prodigy before, but Music for the Jilted Generation was the one that just like hook, line and sinker got its teeth into me, and it sort of helped me transition, you know, my headspace from being all into grunge and rock and alternative music. You know, I've been into Nirvana, Smashing Pumpkins, Soundgarden, these kinds of bands. Prodigy still kind of had that same angst, they had that same rebellion, that same energy, that same fuck you spirit, but with electronic music. So yeah, those are my five albums. And you know, it's hard to really pick one out of all of those. If it was one that was there from the beginning, I'll have to give it to Prodigy. But if it's one that just probably still puts a smile on my face, it's Daft Punk, Homework.
If you're gonna check out any of those albums, I highly suggest you check out Leftism by Left Field. Oh my gosh, what an experience. His picks also draw the connection between punk and electronic music, especially with the selection of Prodigy. Let us know in the comment section below which South African artist that you would love to see on the show. That all rhymes. Guys, thank you so much for watching. Peace.